Collins Street Wicket.
That's right.
And then bound your leg up onto the first rung.
Oh, man. YouTube's very good for all this sort of stuff.
I want you to imagine a football star of today, a Joel Selwood, a Dane Swan, or a Gary Adler Jr. being cut down in his prime by an epidemic. For 3 years in the late 1870s, Carlton football player George Coulthard was named champion of the colony and the equivalent of the Brownlow Medal. But in 1883, Coulthard was dead, aged 27, from tuberculosis. Many of the sad stories that would have occurred in the setting up of the great VFL, as it was in those days.
That's right, and historian Rob Pascoe, Professor Rob Pascoe, is putting together an anthology of players, and he's on the line now. Good evening, Professor.
Good evening, boys. How are we?
Good evening to you, Rob.
Very well.
Tell us your love. Well, where did this love of perhaps the formation of football in Melbourne and Australia begin?
I guess it started because I was working on the East Melbourne Cricket Ground, which some of the listeners would remember, and I was trying to work out the kinds of blokes who would have played there. Of course, that set me back to find out who actually made up those teams in those days. When you go to the records, it's very hard to find them because the AFL today only started his records back in 1897, you know, when they began the VFL, you know, a good 10 or 15 years after Coulthard was playing. And so before then, we've really got no proper records. But a mate of mine named Mark Pennings up in Brisbane went through every newspaper, and you know, he seemed so blind with the microfiche. You know, he pulled out all the games, and he pulled out all the names, and now we have them all. We have about 7,000 names of the players who played between 1858 and 1896.
That's amazing. So in those years, 7,000 players, that's 39 years. This is a monumental task, Professor.
Well, there were about 26 senior clubs in those days because, yeah, clubs came and went. I mean, apart from the big clubs like Carlton, which, of course, are always important clubs, but Coulthard played for Carlton. But the little clubs like Williamstown and South Williamstown, that no one's ever heard of these days, which came and went.
Where was the East Melbourne Football Ground?
It's now a set of apartments, the Buxton apartments at the corner of Jollymont Road and Wellington Parade South. South, what used to be called Gun Alley.
Oh, yes.
Remember Gun Alley, where we used to do the driver training, the testing for new drivers. It's just between there and the railway yard.
Was the MCG there, Rob, in those days?
That's right. Yeah, there were three grounds. There was the East Melbourne Cricket Ground, then the MCG, and then, of course, the Punt Road Oval.
Yeah.
All three of them were full to the capacity of every Sunday afternoon.
But these young players in this very fledgling city would have been like rock stars.
They were, yeah. I mean, every suburb was divided up by parklands from each other. We had a very high rate of owner ownership, so a lot of people built their own houses. And then we had great cable cars and trains that took people from one bit to the other. So the suburban competition was very fierce, and people would come. Yeah, people would go to the local park and watch the heroes play.
Mm. Tell us about George Ditchburn, Robert.
Well, that was amazing. You know, I bought this house in South Yarra about 8-9 years back, and it's got tweets I've written up the top of the pediment. You know, it was the fashion in those days to have the 1880s houses. Then last week, my colleague Mark Bettings sent me an email from Brisbane with all his latest findings. He had this player, George Ditchburn, who lived in tweet site, the Argus, in November 1890, said that George Ditchburn and his wife had a baby and was living at Tweed Side, South Yarra, which of course meant nothing to Mark.
Wow.
Of course, I read it with astonishment. I mean, that's my house. And so I thought, holy hell, this is the first year the house has been finished, and what you know, you've got to secure the player and the baby. You know, what a great bonus that is.
Yeah, going back to the 1880s, who were the top sides of the day, or were there such things?
Yeah, Geelong was a great club. In fact, Geelong supports our research because we give them another five premierships if the AFL allowed it. You know, these are all each year. There wasn't a grand final we have today, but there was a record kept of the senior clubs, and the top clubs were at the top of the list. So the best clubs like Carlton and Geelong, and South Melbourne was a strong club.
Yeah.
Essendon was a strong club. Sadly, Melbourne and St Kilda and University were never strong, but they played all those years, but they weren't a very strong club.
And where did the symbols come from? Sorry, John, are they like the magpies for Collingwood? Do you know that background?
Yes, we do. Yes, they originally called the thieving magpies. and then they thought it wasn't very smart to have reference to thievery from a working class suburb, so it just became the Magpies after their colours. But what's curious is why they chose black and white in the first place. Our theory is that it came from the minstrel shows of the 1890s. It's very popular that people go along in their droves to watch minstrel performances. And so we think that's where the idea of black and white came from.
Yeah. And South Yarra real estate agent Philip Batters has contributed to his story. And this is interesting, Bruce. His great-grandfather, Wally Dolly Batters, St Kilda and Carlton player of the 1880s. Tell us that story, Rob.
Yeah, well, he was a fruiterer. And he was born in Williamstown in 1866, but moved to Paran and had a shop in Chapel Street. Just down from Commercial Road there, there's a street that's called Grey Street that's now sort of runs into the Paran House Commission flats.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's where he lived and that's where he worked. He had a fruit shop. He sold fruit. He sold flowers. And every morning he'd go off to the markets, which in those days were the city, and he'd come back out of Prince's Bridge with his horse and dray.
Yeah.
And one morning in March 1913, the horse bucked, threw him off the horse and killed him. Yeah, so he was a very popular man. And,
and that was on Princess Bridge.
Yeah,
that's right, yeah, that's it.
It's amazing. We're talking about an era where there's no radio, very fledgling papers, no television, so you'd really have to get to that ground. And I wonder how many numbers would go in the 1800s to watch that game.
About 10,000.
Wow.
It was one of the biggest sporting codes in the world at the time. I mean, other cities around the world have similar kind of crowds. I mean, Boston, everyone flocked to see the baseball, of course. But here in Melbourne, the remarkable thing was that women went in almost equal number to men.
Mm.
And we think that a lot of the colours were and the nicknames came from the fact that the women would wear the flowers. So, yeah, Melbourne were the fuchsias.
That's right.
Hawthorne became the Maybloons. When they joined the comp, which was a bit later. The Geelong supporters all wore blue and white, and so that was all one of their colours. But they were called the Pivotonians. They weren't called the Cats until the 1920s. A black cat ran across the field night before they were going to play Carlton, and they were jinxed by Carlton, but they beat Carlton for adopting the cat as their motto.
Isn't that wonderful? That's how the Cats started.
Yeah, and when did they get the handbag moniker?
They got that they had a pretty bad patch there in the 60s.
Yeah.
And what happened was that Alf Brown, the Herald, who loved the sport of putting down, he was a very witty man. He was one of the first people called the handbags. So he was basically, of course, I would call them the pussies. And Lou Richards, same sort of thing. That used these diminutive nicknames as a way of putting down the clubs who were going badly.
And Robert, any home bases, any home grounds that existed then being used now?
They all are. The MCG is still used.
So Windy Hill, Victoria Park.
Now, Windy Hill started in 1920. When Essendon were kicked off East Melbourne Cricket Ground in 1920-21, because the railways were electrified by Clapp. Remember he took out the Rajomet Railway Yard.
Yes.
They owned that land, so they kicked the East Melbourne Cricket Club off there. They inaugurated with Hawthorne. Meanwhile, the Essendon Footy Club, was then called the Same Olds, decided to move out to Windy Hill. They were coaxed there by the Essendon Council. And so that's why they were called the Bombers. Mm. And that's because those days, of course, Essendon was the major airfield. And so there was the Mosquito Fleet all through the 20s, and then they became the Bombers, and they've been the Bombers ever since.
Now Robert, this is obviously a never-ending labour of yours. And do you ever think you're going to finish it, and when will that be?
No, we'll never finish it. We're about 4 years into it, and I mean, we're about halfway. But what's happened is every club has got its own historians. You've got Trevor Ruddle at Richmond, you've got Cole Hutchison at Geelong, you've got Russell Holmesby at St Kilda, you've got Linda Carroll at Melbourne, all these wonderful people.
Mm.
And so they do a lot of the work, and so our job really is to try to help them and send them whatever stuff we find. So most people don't follow AFL, most people follow a club rather than AFL itself.
Yeah.
And our job is really try to sort of to resurrect some of the stuff. And in some ways, some of these clubs have disappeared and you'll never come back. Like, university's gone, never come back.
But of course, these days, I mean, back in those days, we had, like, disease like tuberculosis. We had a couple of world wars as well. I mean, we couldn't imagine some of our players being lost in such circumstances today. Jim Steins was probably the most recent that we lost tragically.
And Sean White, of course.
Sean White, of course.
And
yeah.
St. Einstein's put it, how bloody unfair is that they got one Irishman, like Washington have two.
Yeah.
We lost a lot of boys in the First War with, all the doctors went off to the war, killed, they were, a lot of them were university players. And so university lost a lot of players during the First War and never really came back into contention. So we've lost about 100 BFL, AFL players. Over the major wars.
Now, Robert Pascoe, can we see some of your work as far as a museum is concerned, or a heritage, or the individual clubs have that information?
Now, what we're going to do is we're going to send it to the National Sports Museum, the MCG,
right.
And it'll be available through a portal, so people will be able to type in questions like, who played from Scotch College, who did this, who did that, and ask questions from the database and club their answers. So we're hoping young people will get excited by the heritage. I mean, a lot of football these days is all about the instantaneous gratification of putting a bet on who's going to kick the first goal, which is fine in itself, but there's too much betting in football culture, we think.
Yeah.
So we want kids to understand the heritage. The clubs whose jumpers they wear belong to these traditions that go way back 150 years.
And of course, Robert, if you put this into a book, I mean, it would have to be like volumes and volumes and volumes, so thank goodness for the internet. And I'm guessing you want anyone with photos or stories or documents about 19th century players. Is an email address that you're happy to put over air and to receive material?
Robert.pasco at VU.
Yeah.
Stands for Victoria University, .edu.au.
All right, so it's robert.pasco at vu.edu.au. So,
Robert, thank you very, very much. It's we're just touching the tip of the iceberg of a wonderful story, a wonderful history that we don't know a lot about. We certainly know the recent events, but not back there in the 1870s, the formation of the VFL in Melbourne. So thank you very much indeed, Robert.
A pleasure.
And I'll give you that. Thank you very much. The email address is robert.pasco at VU.
Which stands for Victoria University.
edu.au.
Yeah, all right. And that would be such a mammoth task, Bruce. I mean,
it would be a labour of love.
It would be never-ending, and obviously it's in good hands with Professor Robert Pascoe.
Absolutely.
And his friend Mark Pennings at Queensland University. So so if you can contribute anything, doesn't matter how ill, insignificant you think it is, Robert would love to get hold of some of that.
Love to. Yeah. Thank you very much for speaking with us, Robert. 14 to 10, we go back...